Selamun aleyküm from Istanbul, live from Istanbul with Cihat. We will be speaking about the scientific reputation of Darwinism, science leading to faith, and faith-related topics.
Inshallah.
Inshallah. Shall we start with the complexity of the cell?
Yes, that would be great.
So let's start with our short film that we have about the structure of the cell. A single cell, which is 100 millimeter in size, is more complex than a city. Metropolis.
We have to show the complexity of the cell over and over again, because it's very important to understand that life is not simple to come into existence by blank chances, as evolutionists claim. So it's very important. We have to stress on this, as this is one very important scientific fact, that life is not simple, it's very much complex. MashaAllah.
Inshallah.
The building blocks of the body. Among the smallest human cells are some nerve cells, while the largest cell, the ovum, has a diameter of 5/1000th of an inch, the size of a pinpoint. Each cell is a self-contained living unit, which becomes modified and specialized as it develops and is integrated into the body's systems. When actual functioning cells in tissues and organs are packed together in close proximity, they take on a variety of shapes. Muscle cells, for example, are elongated into fibers. Liver cells are hexagonal, and the cells which line the intestine are column-shaped. The cutaway view of a generalized cell, as presented here and magnified to 6,000 times the average size, reveals the working parts concerned with systems of cell support, maintenance, repair, and multiplication. The cell nucleus, a spherical structure, contains the basic genetic material, deoxyribonucleic acid, or DNA, in the form of chromosomes. The nucleus controls the overall activity of the cell. The nuclear envelope is a two-layered membrane surrounding the nucleus. The envelope acts as a sieve, controlling the continuous flow of chemicals to and from the nucleus. The nucleolus, housed within the nucleus, has, under a microscope, a granular appearance. This is due to its concentration of ribonucleic acid, or RNA. Cytoplasm is the watery medium of the cell in which all the structures are suspended. Most of the work of the cell is carried on in the cytoplasm. The cell membrane is a soft, pliable skin which acts as a control gate for the entry and exit of substances involved in cell function. The endoplasmic reticulum is a network of flattened sacs and tubes which provides a communication channel for materials passing between the nucleus and the cell's environment. The lysosomes are simple sacs which store enzymes, the powerful chemicals involved in digestion. The mitochondria are the main sites of energy production within the cell. Pits on the surface of the cell capture fluid which contains large molecules, such as proteins, and carry it toward the interior. The ribosomes are the sites where proteins are made. They contain RNA similar to that in the nucleus. The centrioles are involved in cell division, during which they move apart to opposite poles of the cell, leaving a delicate tracery within the cytoplasm. And Golgi's complex acts as a depot for the storage and secretion of cell products. Working around the clock, the human cell is comparable to a small factory. Like a factory, the cell takes in a continuous flow of raw materials for processing and packaging of its own chemical waste ready for disposal.
The cell is the basic unit of all organisms.
So as you see, the cell is a very complex structure with many organelles, and it produces protein molecules like 2,000 in a second. And the number of the protein molecules in a single human cell is about estimated to be 10 billion. So its complexity is more than anything humans can imagine. It's the most complex structure in the universe, the cell itself, or one of the most complex structures. Of course, a structure like this shows us in the artistry of the Creator.
Yes.
The infinite power of the Creator, the infinite wisdom of the Creator. Mm-hmm. At the time of the Charles Darwin, they always thought about that the cell is nothing but a jelly full of water, or it's balloon-like full of jelly, something like that, because they didn't have any microscope at this time. They didn't know anything about the molecular biology. They didn't know anything about the genetics or the existence of the DNA. Mm-hmm. However, science has shown us single cell is even more complex than the largest city of the world. And from the fossil evidence, we know the first cell on Earth 3.5 billion years ago appeared all at once and fully formed. It's called cyanobacteria, which can do photosynthesis. And no change since 3.5 billion years. We still have the cyanobacteria, which can do photosynthesis, mm-hmm. and which had it all of a sudden 3.5 billion years ago. And that proves us the creation, of course, inshallah.
Yes, mashallah. Think about ourselves. Our body is composed of at least 100 trillion cells. This is a huge number that we cannot even count. Each second counting one cell, our life is not enough to count the whole. So and when we observe the complexity in the cell, we see that there is an information, and this information is being processed. So in order to function, in order to get the functioning of the cell, so there is the control mechanisms at each step, so as to get the functioning cell as a whole. So even we cannot control, we cannot count our cells, but our whole body is under control. Do we control ourselves? Do we control any of our cells? No. It's obviously no. Because each cell is under the control of the creator of it. That is Allah for sure.
Inshallah.
That's obvious. This is a scientific fact. Because the quality control within the cell shows us that there is a quality check, that is, there is a wisdom which knows what is good and what is bad, what is right and what is wrong. So creates accordingly. Do we know what is good and what is bad for our body, what is good and bad for our cells? No. We are not a molecular biologist from the very moment that we start living on this earth. But our cells rely on this very important information within the DNA and all these quality checkpoints by creation of Allah.
Inshallah. If you go at the level of molecules and check with the, from point of view of molecular biology, there are many things happening which involves a lot of intelligence and consciousness in the cell. Actually, we can give some examples which shows us even more complexity at the molecular level. This is a short film about the protein synthesis and the structure of the DNA inside the cell.
Francis Crick first proposed that chemicals called bases along the spine of the DNA molecule function as alphabetic characters in a written language or digital characters in a machine.
So we see the structure of the DNA, which is a helical structure. It's consists of four letters. It's a four-letter alphabet. For example, human DNA has 3.2 billion letters.
Yes.
So about 1 million pages of encyclopedia.
Yes.
So this is a huge amount of information packed in 1,000 millimeter in size in the nucleus of the cell.
This is a huge information, and even to map the DNA of the human being, it lasted about 10 years. All the computers on Earth worked for that. The computers in the laboratories worked all together from different countries, from different continents. Get involved in this research, so as to map the DNA, so as to map the what are the A, T, G, C letters are of, so as to show our DNA code.
Yeah, they just shown
just the code
sequence,
itself.
The sequence, yes, of letters, but we don't know many of the meanings of the genes.
Not yet.
Or DNA sequences. For example, we talked about a publication 2 days ago that shows that Darwin once said there is parts of the DNA. They called it junk DNA because we didn't know the function of these DNA parts. However, most recent research is showing us that even there is no such thing as junk DNA because there are parts of the DNA which control the activities of the genes. So every part of DNA has another code which controls the other codes, such as the genes, for example, the activity of the genes, and decides and controls which cell is to be transformed, which cell? The cell is transformed, what kind of cell? For example, there are 206 different cells in the human body. And what determines the cell type is the activity of certain genes. But who decides the activity of certain genes?
Yes.
So it turns out certain parts, which are called previously the junk DNA, controls the activity of the genes and determines the cell type, mm-hmm. whether it's going to be a muscle cell or a nerve cell mm-hmm. or a retinal cell, for example. Yes. So the complexity is of the DNA is far more than we can think about, actually. It's beyond imagination. Every day, new evidence shows us every single part of the DNA has a certain function.
Yes. So we can draw a very important conclusion from this point, that scientific fact, that that's so-called junk DNA parts, later on understood to be the code of the code, the code part of the DNA, which controls what genes, which genes to be switched on and switched off, at when and where to be switched on and off. So these are controlling points, controlling codes that decide when to secrete which hormones or enzymes, produce what proteins, and when. So there's a decision being made, and when we go and look at these codes, they are only made up of atoms. Atoms cannot make decisions. They have no power. They don't have any mind to think. They do not have any ability or any. These are just inanimate, inorganic matter. These are just atoms that has nothing to do with thinking or taking decisions or counting time. They do not have any clock at all. It's obviously proving us that there is Allah's creation momentarily. So Allah creates us every moment, every second, every moment, every year. He changes our shape. He changes our needs and creates what we need accordingly. Yeah. So that is how Allah's creation goes on. So Allah's creation goes on from the very moment that He starts creating us and going on still, mashallah.
Yes, and these parts of the DNA that we just talked about, they call it junk DNA, has always have a certain function. And if there is any mistake that generates severe diseases, for example, there is a syndrome called Fragile X syndrome. It is the major cause of mental retardation in the human beings. It's called Fragile X syndrome. It's a genetic disease. Normally, there is a triplet of letters, CGG, which is repeated 30 times
in
normal DNA.
Yes.
However, in Fragile X, it is repeated hundreds of times, and that generates a very severe mental retardation. It's called Fragile X syndrome. Mm-hmm. And also Huntington disease, another neurological disease which generates mm-hmm. movement disorder, is also a triplet repetition disorder. Mm-hmm. This is also a severe disease, Huntington disease. Mm-hmm. It's also a triplet repetition disorder that shows us every part of the DNA has certain function.
Yes.
And if there is any mutation or any change,
excess of the
in
information,
the repetition of the letters, yeah,
yes.
That generates a very severe disease.
Yes. So according to evolutionists, they were claiming that if the information is duplicated, then there is increase in the information, the complexity would increase. And the situation of the species would improve. However, we see that just the increase of the specific parts of the DNA in number, repetition of the specific parts of the DNA, does not bring improvement in the species, does not increase the information in that DNA, but decrease, will cause diseases as we observe in the clinic.
This is also a very important evidence, as we just talked about, as you just said. And there are, for example, genes. The activity of genes is controlled by the regions which are next to the genes. Mm-hmm. Parts of the DNA control the activity of the genes. So If you change, sometimes the places of the genes are being changed because there are certain parts of the DNA, the genes, they can change their position over the DNA. They are called transposons. Mm-hmm. And evolutionist Darwinists try to show this change of the genes as a so-called evidence for evolution, these transposons or retrotransposons. However, if you change the places of the DNA, of the genes in the DNA, that also brings severe damage most of the time, because there are controlling regions next to the genes which control the activity of the genes.
Yes.
So changing the place damages the information in the DNA, and that also bring harm to the living things. So there is no mechanism, basically, we understand, we'll show also in this film, further, we'll have further information. There is no mechanism that Allah did not create any mechanism which can increase the genetic information in the DNA, which cannot, there is no mechanism which can generate new genetic information, which is a must of the evolution. That is
brand
the reason.
Brand new genetic information.
Yes, brand new genetic information, which would add brand new genes, brand new proteins,
yes,
which will be beneficial for the living thing. There is no such thing.
Yes.
Because there is no such mechanism. The only mechanism which is created, which is inherent to the living things, is the copying of the DNA, making the copy of the DNA.
Yes.
Only copy can be made because there are proteins in the DNA, which are encoded in the DNA, which can copy the information letter by letter. And that is the only mechanism which exists in the DNA, but there is no mechanism which can add new genetic information. So that means no evolution, of course.
Yes.
That is the reason why we see the living things with all the complexity appearing all of a sudden in the history. We know this from the fossil evidence, of course. The fossils tells us that the living things appear all at once, fully formed, and they never change. That means all the information that these living things possess from generation to generation exist from the first sample of this species. For example, there are rabbits. If you go far back enough in time, you meet the first rabbit having the information in the DNA, which is exactly the same after many of generations, after millions of years, because it is being passed from generation to generation by the copying mechanisms, which is inherent to the living things, which these cells,
yes,
copying of the DNA. But the first DNA possess all the proteins, all the genes that the last sample has.
Mm-hmm.
For the same thing for the human beings. The first human being, Adam alayhi salam, and his wife, has all the genetic information,
yes,
that we have today.
Mm-hmm.
So we got this information by copying. After Adam alayhi salam, over thousands of years, on and off, by copying from the first DNA, inshallah. Because Allah created this mechanism,
yes,
in a perfect way. And of course there are proofreading, which corrects the mistakes.
Yes.
So that's the reason why the mutations in the DNA is being corrected. So basically, to summarize, the only mechanism which is created is the copying mechanism, but there is no mechanism which can add new genetic information. And it is impossible, randomly,
yes,
through mutations, to add new genetic information.
This scientific fact is valid for all species on Earth. The bacteria, the algae, or the human body cells, the animal cells, the plant cells, all rely on the proofreading of the DNA. When they go on division, phases of the division, cell cycle, the DNA is, or the RNA, whatever, according to the type of the cell, is being copied, and there is proofreading, as you just told about that, and there is no mistake. Each mistake is being detected and just corrected,
yeah,
mashallah.
And
there are special mechanisms for that, created for the correction of these mistakes.
Yeah, and because of this, the fossils shows us that there is no change for millions of years.
Mm-hmm.
There are 350 million fossils, there are no transitional forms, and the species appear abruptly, and they do not change during the tenure on the Earth.
Yes.
And this is admitted by the most important paleontologists, Darwinist paleontologists, such as Stephen Jay Gould, for example. Stephen Jay Gould says, fossils have two features, stasis and sudden appearance. Stasis means, he says, the species do not change during the tenure on the Earth. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that means, of course, no evolution, because as we said, there is no mechanism of evolution. There is no mechanism which can add new genetic information. So we can go on with the film, actually.
This animation shows how this digital information directs protein synthesis. First, a large protein complex separates the tightly wound strands of the DNA to prepare it to be copied. During this process of transcription, a protein complex called a polymerase produces a single-stranded copy of the original.
So as we see now, this is the copying mechanism for the DNA. There are enzymes, the polymerase enzyme, which can make the copy from the DNA. But that's it. Allah created the mechanism which can make the copy of the DNA, yes. Inshallah.
Instructions. Here we see this copy, the messenger RNA molecule, being constructed inside the polymerase as individual bases are positioned and added to the growing strand. Now we see the polymerase in action from the outside as it spits out the messenger RNA transcript. Next, this RNA transcript approaches and passes through a molecular machine called the nuclear pore complex, an information recognition device that controls the flow of information in and out of the cell's nucleus.
So there's a huge, mashallah, glorious creation in that, because these gates of the nucleus can recognize the molecules and they let them out.
Yes.
So they show in
the right molecule.
They show consciousness. Yes. They're like, imagine, for example, in a building, there are some guards standing in front of the gates and only let the people they know inside of this building.
Yes.
These are conscious human beings, but these are gates which are made of unconscious atoms, but they show consciousness. And of course, then the question follows, whose consciousness is that? It's not their consciousness, and whose consciousness is that? And then, of course, we know Allah's consciousness, Allah's wisdom, inshallah. That is a reflection of Allah's wisdom. Because these molecules, if they exit the cell, they are meaningless. They are a heap of atoms. Mm-hmm. They don't mean anything. But inside the cell, all these molecules show great consciousness, mashallah.
Now we see the genetic assembly instructions on the messenger RNA approaching and arriving at a two-part chemical factory called a ribosome, the site of protein synthesis. As the messenger RNA transcript passes through the ribosome, the process of translation begins.
So as you see, this is the protein factory, but it's also made of the proteins and RNA molecules, and of course, it does the production, which cannot be duplicated by the human beings. So this is also a great consciousness. We cannot produce protein molecules in the high-tech laboratories without having other proteins. And a single protein cannot be produced in the nature, because it requires all these mechanisms that we see right now in the film in a very simplified form. Of course, it is more complex, because hundreds of different enzymes are required for this production.
Yes.
During translation, a mechanical assembly line builds a specifically sequenced chain of amino acids in accord with the instructions on the transcript. These amino acids are transported from other parts of the cell by molecules called transfer RNAs, which link specific sequences of bases to corresponding amino acids. The sequential arrangement of the amino acids determines the type of protein constructed.
So this is also amazing, because this is a very fast process. 20 to 30 different amino acids are being added in 1 second to each other by the proteins, because they require, for example, peptide bonds between the amino acids, and a specific enzyme is required, which is also a protein, peptidyl transferase. And it is also a question, who brings that transfer molecules called transfer RNAs, bring the correct amino acid to the site of action, as we have seen. But there are 20 of them are added in 1 second to each other. So who brings these correct amino acids to this site? Mm-hmm. What kind of consciousness is that? Without making any mistakes, and 20 of them are added in 1 second. 20 different amino acids added in 1 second to each other, but the correct ones. So this is something we should think about. With an atomic precision, these things are happening without making any mistakes. And 2,000 proteins are produced in 1 second, in one cell, mashallah.
Mashallah.
When the construction of the chain is complete, it is transported to a barrel-shaped machine that helps fold it into the precise shape required to perform its function.
So this is another organelle. The simple chain of protein does not mean anything. It has to be folded three-dimensionally. It has a primary structure, but it has a secondary structure, alpha helix and beta sheets. But this is not enough. It is brought to a cell organelle, and this is the transport is done by the proteins. It is brought to the Golgi apparatus for the three-dimensional folding, and there are this process is called post-translational modification. For the post-translational modification, more than 1,150 other enzymes are required. They add chemicals to these amino acids, and they fold it three-dimensionally. And this is a very fast process, which is done in very, very small fractions of a second. Mm-hmm. But it is always done in the correct way. There are infinite alternatives for the three-dimensional folding of the protein. Like we can, for example, fold a paper, this paper, in many different alternatives, infinite alternatives, anyway we can, but only one of them is correct for this protein to be functional, and it is always done in the correct way, done by more than 1,000 enzymes. Mm-hmm. So this is amazing, mashallah. This is to glorify Allah. Allah is Kabir.
Mashallah.
Allah knows everything, inshallah. Allah shows his artistry, infinite artistry, mashallah.
After the chain is folded into a protein, it is released into the outer cytoplasm to do its job in the cell.
So for this process, a barcode, a postcode is added to this protein molecule, and it is carried to the site of function. So this Golgi apparatus is also functions as a post office. So there is a coding system inside the cell which adds a certain molecules to the end of the amino acid, which works as like a postcode. So in that way, it is carried by the proteins. These protein molecules carried by other proteins to the site of action, to the correct address, because of this postcode. So the postcode is started to be used by the human beings at the end of the 20th century, mm-hmm. since several decades, right? But it has been used inside of the cell since 3.5 billion years, mashallah.
Mashallah.
And who created that system? Of course, Allah. It's obviously Allah is the creator of all this complexity.
Inshallah.
Yes, mashallah.
So this is the micro level that how Allah creates. So these each saw how the proteins fold, how proteins are being synthesized in just a single cell, and how there is a micro world that is not cannot be explained by blunt chances or coincidence at all, but there is creation of an all-knowing, all-wise Allah. That's the creation of Allah for sure. And these cells, when they come together, they form tissues. Then tissues come together to form the organs or extremities, and then the whole body is being formed. Then we have another three-dimensional structure, that is the body of an animal, of a human being, or an insect. And let's see a dragonfly, for example. I think we have the picture of that dragonfly. This is just an incredible miraculous insect. We have a three-dimensional structure of the dragonfly right here. And here you see how those cells and which those cells come together to form the tissues, and then they form the organs. For example, they form the eyes. They form the wings. That four-winged structure, very special structure, and the intestinal structure or the neuronal structure of the insect, like we have other systems and organs. Let's observe this dragonfly. It has the perfect flight that can be observable in the animal kingdom. And they have four large independent wings carrying the weight of the dragonfly. And this feature enables the insect to make sudden maneuvers, increase its speed, and fly at a speed that reaches 10 meters per second. That is 33 feet a second. It's a very high speed. And let's see the sight capacity, its eyes. It's another miraculous structure that we observe in the animal kingdom of the dragonfly, because it can make that insect can make sudden maneuvers at high speed, but even the eye of the dragonfly is it is the very finest insect eye in the world, because it has 30,000 individual eyes, and it has a very perfect seeing ability.
MashaAllah.
Flying at these high speeds and having that maneuvers, immediate, instant maneuvers. It has such an incredible example of creation, mashallah. And the eyes, when we look at the eyes, they are made up of two hemispheres covering half of its head, and they provide a very broad field of vision for the insect. And with these extraordinary eyes, the dragonfly can almost see what's happening even behind its back. That's very important. And the dragonfly has a perfectly structured individual system. So we can conclude. And the slightest deficiency of any one part of these systems will cause the other systems to become useless at all. That's another conclusion that we can derive. However, all the systems have been created perfectly, and the creature survives by means of these. If there is no four-winged structure, there will be no high-speed flying. There will be no maneuvers. It will be hunted by its enemies easily otherwise. Or if there is no perfect eye structure that it has, that 30,000 lens structure of each eye is made up of 30,000 lens structure. If there is no such eye structure, there will be no perfect vision at all. So all together, all systems should be present at the same time, at the same insect. So it has a very unique design. We observe in the dragonfly, and this belongs to Allah for sure. He has the knowledge of all creation. And it's very easy for Allah to create such a design, such an insect, with such intricate systems and incredible functioning parts work all together, which rely on one another, mashallah. And if we go back to the micro world of the cell, which is made up of proteins, being able to function with the proteins being synthesized in itself according to the information in the DNA, and then come to see that three-dimensional structure of the dragonfly, there is obviously a miraculous creation in this. Yeah. Because the cells, that they behave according to the place where they are. According to, for example, one cell is being functioning as a wing cell or as an eye cell if it is being created at the eye location, or an intestinal cell if it is created at the intestinal location. So each cell functions. Each cell synthesizes different proteins according to the place it is being created at.
So there are also certain genes which determines
yes
which body part is going to have what kind of structure.
Yes.
Then they have a perfect symmetry, and they have a golden ratio in the creation. In the wings, for example, there is golden ratio.
MashaAllah.
Or in the eyes. And as you said, there are 30,000 different lenses in dragonfly eye.
Mm-hmm. Which in
is
each eye.
Something beyond the imagination.
Yes.
And it's a very small place. It's a very small structure. But there are 30,000 lenses. Mm-hmm. And this is a very, very complex eye system. And the genetic information is extremely complex, which determines this structure of the eyes, mm-hmm. and which determines the place of the eye. Mm-hmm. For example, if there is any mutation in the gene which controls the body parts, which body part is going to be where, they are called Hox genes. They have, for example, a antenna or a leg is sticking out from the head mm-hmm. instead of an antenna. So that shows us any mutation damages this complex structure.
Yes.
So there is no mechanism for Darwinism.
Yes.
But all the evidences that you give us points to a creator, yes. inshallah.
Yes, there are information in each cell. There is the DNA, which tells which cell to behave according to where it is being placed at. But we can compare this situation like the parts of a huge plane, a Boeing 747, for example, a jumbo jet. If we have the parts being present at a certain location, but if they are not at the right location, functioning yet, then they have to be collected by workers and mounted all together as a plan, as a structural plan, like a design plan in the hands of the engineers or the workers. So they have to be mounted, and that three-dimensional structure of the plane should be instructed, should be constructed. However, are there any workers that we observe in the creation of the insect or our bodies when we are at the embryological stages, that we, the developmental stages in our mother's womb? No, there are no workers. But Allah's, this points to the creation, Allah's infinite power and will. So it's obvious that there is no workers. There is no other third party but Allah, which creates all, which commands each cell to behave to where it is located at, to divide whenever Allah wants, to decide which gene to when it's to be switched on or off. That is Allah's creation. There is no worker or insect cannot, that small insect cannot decide which organ to function in which manner. Or we cannot even have the information of how our liver can function, our liver cells would function. Or our brain cells would create such electricity in millivolts. We do not have any information of the electricity until the 20th century. So those people were still having that neuronal functions. They were creating electrical signals. And even people who do not have any information about the physiology of the human body, they still have the ability of all those functions in each cells. There is Allah's creation for sure. And there is control. And this control and creation belongs to an all-knowing, all-wise creator, that is Allah for sure.
Inshallah. Well, the complexity that you're just talking is shows us that there is no such thing from progress from the primitive to complex. And the complexity of these things, such as the eye, for example, the dragonfly, which consists of 30,000 different lenses, is irreducible. You cannot have a more primitive form. And in fact, of course, we know this also from the fossil evidence, a very concrete evidence. The only way to know what kind of living things lived in the past and when did they appear, we can only know from the fossil evidence. So if you check the fossil evidence, we come across the first eye, which is similar, as we see over here, if you can show the slide on the screen, and we see that the first eye is a trilobite eye. It is a trilobite eye, mm-hmm. which appears all of a sudden in the history of life. And can we show the slide, please? Maybe there's a technical problem. Yes. So we see this is the first eye in the history of life. On the left-hand side, it's a trilobite eye. It consists of many honeycomb-like cells. But we see the dragonfly eye on the right-hand side. They are very similar. So the compound eye system is very similar. And this is the first eye. So the first eye is no different than today's mm-hmm. eye. It is. It has the same complexity. So there is no progress from the primitive to complex. And the first eye appears all of a sudden in a very complex form. In fact, trilobite eye is a very complex eye system, compound eye system, which consists of 3,000 lenses, which are made of calcite, calcium carbonates, these lenses. And it has a double lens system. And each honeycomb-like cell that are double lens, and which have different indices, refraction indices. So the first eye appears all of a sudden in a very complex form, and it is the same after how many years? 540 million years. This is the eye from the trilobite, which lived 540 million years ago in the Cambrian period. So of course, that defeats Darwinism completely.
Sure.
So there is no such thing from increase the progression from primitive to complex.
No.
And as we said, these are irreducibly complex structures. Human eye, for example, consists of many parts, and the molecular biology is also even more complex. So it cannot be exist in a more in a primitive form.
Yes.
It does not function if any of these components is missing. So of course Charles Darwin was aware of this fact. Mm-hmm. And he said, to suppose that the eye, with all its inimitable contrivances for adjusting the focus to different distances, for admitting different amounts of light, and for the correction of spherical and chromatic aberration, could have been formed by natural selection. He says, all these complexity functions of the eye could have been formed by natural selection. This imaginary mechanism of evolution that he claimed, seems, he says, I freely confess, absurd in the highest degree. So basically he says, evolution is absurd in the highest degree. And who says that? Charles Darwin himself says that. Mm-hmm. And he wrote this in the book Origin of Species.
Yes.
So he says, evolution is absurd in the highest degree in the book Origin of Species, where he started to defend evolution. He knew that evolution is nothing science. And he said, thinking about the eye makes me cold all over, in one of the letters he wrote to his friends, mm-hmm. I think S. A. Gray. And he said, thinking about the eye makes me cold all over.
Yes.
Because the structure of the eye shows us Allah created it.
Yes.
And even the small child, 5-year-old child, can understand the complexity of the eye tells us there is a creator with infinite wisdom, inshallah.
Yes. In the 19th century, in 1900s, year 1900s, people were believing that there are useless organs which are leftovers from our so-called evolutionary history. And they were claiming that, for example, our thyroid gland is useless because they were not able to understand how it functions. They had no means of, for example, electron microscopy to understand its functions. So they were just claiming that thyroid gland, which is now we know that it's very important in our in the functioning of all the body. The metabolism, the rate of the metabolism is being directed with the functioning of the thyroid gland. Without thyroid gland, there is no growth at all, for example. Growth of the body, or the function of the body, the cells would not function, the rate of the heart would not be controlled, for example. Or they were claiming again that our liver were, thymus was another important gland. Like thyroid, again they were claiming the thymus gland as to be another vestigial organ. However, later on it was understood in our day in our age, it was understood that it was a very important organ, a tissue, which tells the...
produce T lymphocytes.
The T lymphocytes where to go and detect what is foreign and what is our human body cells. Teaches that is a special part, a special tissue, which teaches that T lymphocytes how to behave when they were just traveling in the human body. So even they were claiming the liver, our liver, to be another vestigial organ, because they had again no means of investigation of how liver works or what it how it functions. However, we now know that liver, each liver cell has at least 500 very important vital functions. Just a single microscopic liver cell has at least 500 very important vital functions that cannot be explained as useless in any way. And for example, if you go to the details of what the liver, our organ liver, works for. For example, it's a perfect filter of the blood, because it filters the wastes, like the kidney filters our body's water-soluble wastes out of the body in the form of urine. Again, liver, our liver, purifies our blood circulation, and it gets the, for example, the hormones, the drugs that we use, and gets these chemical waste out of our body just by metabolizing them, degrading them in a very important, in a very unique way, by chemical reactions that we cannot even copy, we cannot even duplicate in the most advanced laboratories yet, because we cannot copy the function of the liver. Do we copy the function of the kidney? Yes, we can copy, we can duplicate the function of the kidney to some extent, but we cannot copy the function of the kidney in any way. So otherwise, if the liver would not purify our blood from those hormones or waste products of the drugs, those would be seriously poisonous to our body. And another important function, for example, the liver is the liver produces the sources of energy in the body. And one of the features of the liver is to produce glucose, which is one of the most important sources of energy in the body. And glucose, which is taken from nutrients, is converted into glycogen, and it is stored in the liver. When we get our nutrients to our intestinal system, these are being taken with the intestinal cells and being directed to the liver, and then being metabolized in the liver at the very first step. And the liver constantly checks the glucose ratio, the concentration of the glucose in the blood. Because, for example, our brain resides on the very specific levels of the glucose in the blood circulation. So it constantly checks our blood glucose level. And if the level decreases, then it uses that stored glycogen, turns glycogen into glucose, and gives glucose into the blood, into our blood circulation. Do we control that? No. There is no control by us. But there is a special control mechanism that Allah controls, Allah creates. And Allah still goes on giving life to us, mashallah. Or again, also our liver cells convert carbohydrates into glycogen, glycogen if we do not need any glucose, or carbohydrates into glucose if they are needed, if we are in need of glucose in any way. Or even they can, liver cells can turn the fats that triglycerides, that fatty chemicals into glucose if they are needed to. Even we cannot manage to convert any fat cells, any fat chemicals, fatty chemicals or triglycerides in the laboratory to into glucose. We cannot copy that reactions. So it's another, it provides another logistic place. It has a logistic support function to our immune system, because it also produces globulins, which are elements of the immune system and enzymes at the same time. And these substances are of vital importance for human life, because our immune system rely on the existence of the globulins in order to produce the antibodies. It needs globulins, that specially created proteins, or enzymes at the same time. So it has another vital important vital function, or it stores blood and controls our blood pressure. If we have a very high blood pressure, it gets it's just like a sponge function. It gets the high amount of blood amount into it, and it gets swelled. Or if we are in need of high, if our blood pressure decreases, then it constricts, it's being contracted to give more blood to the circulation. It's just another very important vital function for our life. Or it cleans the bacteria, because when we get the nutrients from our intestines, there are bacteria in that. So the very first place, the very first location in the liver that our nutrients face is very special cells that are named to be Kupffer cells, which are one part of our immune system. These are like macrophages that are being located at that very specific location to detect the bacteria, the foreign bodies, and engulf them and eliminate them and stop them from entering into our body, our blood circulation. That's another very vital function for our body that we observe in the liver. And they work efficiently. All the cells of the liver work efficiently, because during the use of glucose in the muscles, everybody knows that there's lactic acid comes out as a waste product of the metabolism in the muscle cells. And as long as the lactic acid remains in the muscle, it causes pain and prevents our muscles functioning. So there's pain in our muscles, and there is no way for us to be able to move anymore. And liver here at that moment, at that very specific moment, liver collects this lactic acid from muscles and converts them into glucose to be used in the body. So there's this is a very incredible function that we observe in the liver, because it converts a disadvantageous chemical, lactic acid, into an advantageous molecule, that's glucose, for our sake, mashallah.
Mashallah.
So, and it is it's another very important place, the liver is another important place for the production of the red blood cells in our body. Just like the red blood cells are being synthesized in our bones, inside our bones. Again, we see that red blood cells are being produced in our livers as well, mashallah. And it's the most capable storage of the body. One place that's very most capable storage for the body. It stores all minerals, proteins, and little amount of fat and vitamins that are needed for our for the function of functioning of the different cell types, all that are throughout our body, mashallah. So these are only some of the functions of the liver that I told, because normally a liver cell is able to perform more than 500 functions, at least 500. And furthermore, these functions are mostly carried out simultaneously. So there is no way, there is no accidental happenings in the body, there is no useless organ at all. Each cell is being created to function for vital functioning, for vital functions, mashallah. So Allah creates them for each of them, Allah creates each cell for a reason, for not some vestigial functions, useless function, but for each them for some vital function.
How could it be vestigial by having more than 500 mashallah functions?
Yes.
And which are, most of them are essential for life actually,
yes,
to and stay alive.
In one verse Allah states in Surah Al-Hajj, verse number 64, Asik refuge in Allah from the curse of Satan, Allah states, everything in the heavens and everything in the earth belongs to Him. Allah is the rich beyond need, the praiseworthy. So everything that we come across with, whether if it is an insect, it is an animal, plant, or our human body cells, Allah creates them at all. Allah creates them from the very moment that they are being created, they first appear, or they go on in the later days of their life. MashaAllah, Allah goes on them creating, okay, one by one. Each protein is being created by Allah, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Yeah. And Allah is rich beyond need. He is the praiseworthy, mashallah. So we have to praise Allah for His blessings that He gives us. For example, each function of the liver, we have to praise for each of these functions to praise Allah, mashallah, inshallah.
Inshallah. Yeah, the liver, just that example shows us there is no such thing as chance or Allah is the creator, because the complexity, remember, the whole liver originates from a single cell. And who tells them to transform into liver cells, where to start and where to stop? A liver cell by itself does not mean anything, but by coming together, they perform all these functions.
Yes.
And also, the liver has the capability to regenerate. And how do they know that they have to regenerate, first of all?
Like
who
no
tells
other,
them?
Like no other organs at all.
Yeah, and where to start and where to stop? The livers are always similar for of the human beings.
The shape of
who tells them to stop there? Mm-hmm. And they perform very specific functions by collaborating, all these cells. They do chemical functions, metabolism, they have functions for immunity. These are complexities beyond the imagination. Certain genes are activated for a certain time, for a certain amount, and they stop. Mm-hmm. The liver does not reach, for example, the size of 15 kilograms, for example, but it has a certain function, a certain size, and just stops there, and certain amount of function, not more, not less, because too much is damaging, and less is also damaging. So at every single part that gives us, that points to an artist, inshallah, mm-hmm, and that is Allah, with His infinite artistry, inshallah, who creates this, all these things. And for living beings, the most concrete evidence is to check the fossil evidence. Mm-hmm. We always show some fossils, and we will show also some fossils today. Mm-hmm. That shows us that the living beings do not change for millions of years after their emergence in the history of life. They emerge fully formed, and they never change for millions of years. Mm-hmm. One of them is, for example, a sturgeon that I would like to show. It's a 150 million year old fossil that we have of a sturgeon. If we can. Yes, this is a 150 million years old fossil, and so today's form, exactly the same. And I would like to also show you another fossil of a plant. Let me show you. This is a how many years was that? It's a poplar leaf, which is, I'm sorry, 50 million years old. 50 million years old fossil. Poplar leaf. and today's form, exactly the same, millimetrically the same. No change for 50 million years.
And we have thousands of such fossils, or poplars, poplar leaves.
Yes.
And just show lots of evidence we have that, we have lots of evidence which show that there is no change of the species at all.
Yes. So, mashallah. So, mashallah. Fossil evidence, impossibility of the emergence of the proteins, and all the details shows these are the signs of course, of creation by Allah, inshallah, mashallah. Evidences for creation by Allah. Now, of course, these evidences existed before. We had fossils for millions of years. However, only end times is the time for Darwinism to be refuted, Darwinism to be crushed, destroyed actually, because of Mehdi alayhi salam. And there are many signs of Mehdi alayhi salam is given, and of course, one of the major signs of Mehdi alayhi salam, major duties actually, is the first duty, Sayyid Nursi, Bediüzzaman Sayyid Nursi says, his first duty was to silence Maddiyun and Tabiyun, materialism and naturalism, and Darwinism. So materialism and Darwinism will be silenced by Mehdi alayhi salam completely, it says. Mm-hmm. So that is also another sign of the end times, inshallah. And there are many other signs stated in the hadiths, and one of them is the appearance of the Halley Comet. And Halley Comet is appeared in 1980s. And so it is also one of the signs of the appearance of Mehdi alayhi salam. We would like to show you a film, a short film about the comet, Halley Comet, inshallah.
Of a comet is one of the portents of the coming of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam. A star with a luminous tail will rise from the east before Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam emerges. Halley's comet passed by the Earth in Hijri 1406 or 1986 AD. This comet is a bright, luminous star. Before he, Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam, arrives, a comet will appear in the east, giving out an illumination. Halley's comet travels from east to west. This final passage of the comet in the end times heralds the appearance of Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam, as revealed in the hadiths. The star's rise will occur after the eclipse of the sun and the moon. Halley's comet appeared in the wake of the eclipses of the sun and the moon in 1981 and 1982. Or Hijri 1401 and 1402. History, wherever this comet has passed by, events that represent significant turning points with regard to Muslims have taken place. Some of these are revealed in the accounts narrated by our Prophet, peace be upon him. According to these accounts, when the comet was seen, the people of the Prophet Noah alayhi salam were destroyed. The Prophet Abraham alayhi salam was cast into the fire. Pharaoh and his tribe were destroyed. The Prophet Jesus alayhi salam was born. Our Prophet, peace be upon him, began receiving the first revelation. The Ottoman Empire made its appearance. And Constantinople, Istanbul, was captured by Sultan Mehmed the Conqueror. Some interesting figures linked to Halley's Comet. Interestingly, some figures pertaining to the comet are multiples of 19. For example, Halley's Comet appears every 76 years. 19 times 4 equals 76. And was last seen in Hijri 1406. 19 times 74 equals 1406. Surat al-Mudathir, which refers to the miracle of 19 in the Quran, is the 74th surah. Moreover, its 30th verse reveals that 19 is a means of mercy for believers and a fitna for unbelievers. As is known, it is stated in verse 30 of Surat al-Mudathir, Surah 74, that the number 19 is instrumental in being a mercy for believers, while being a fitna for unbelievers. This miraculous relation of Halley's comet to the number 19 may point at giving the good news of it being a strife for unbelievers, while being a mercy for believers. In Surat Al-Mudathir 74, 1 and 2, Allah commands our Prophet, peace be upon him, O you who are enveloped in your cloak, arise and warn. The meaning is clear. Yet there may be a hidden meaning. The one enveloped in a cloak may well refer to Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salam, who is from our Prophet's peace be upon him lineage, and whose appearance will be signaled by the rise of Ali's comet in 1406 AH. Another miraculous aspect is that Halley's Comet's passage by the Earth in 1986 is the 19th since the prophethood was bestowed on the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in 607 AD.
Yeah, mashallah. So,
mashallah.
We have seen, this is one of the signs of appearance of the Mahdi. And there are many signs, more than 150 signs, mashallah. They are all being fulfilled, as stated. And some of the major signs are only happened once in the history of life. Halley Comet is passed 19 times as our Prophet, but however, some of the signs only happen once, such as the stopping the water of the Euphrates, or the bloody attack to the Kaaba. They only happen once, inshallah, mm-hmm. one after another one, as stated by our Prophet, like pieces of the necklace. In 30 years more than, we have seen more than 150 signs, which shows us that Mahdi must have appeared. He is active now, inshallah, and we will see Mahdi alayhi salam and Isa alayhi salam soon, inshallah, in mostly 10 years.
Inshallah.
Inshallah. So, there is secret of the test. We have a film about that, inshallah. That we would like to show you.
There is an important secret hidden in the atmosphere of trial that makes up this world. Those believers who are aware of it treat the difficulties they encounter with great eagerness, joy, and patience. At the heart of this secret lies the fact of fate. A Muslim knows that God has created everything with its own destiny, and that whatever happens to him does so by the will of God. This is how the Quran states that fact. The keys of the unseen are in his possession. No one knows them but him. He knows everything in the land and sea. No leaf falls without his knowing it. There is no seed in the darkness of the earth, and nothing moist or dry which is not in a clear book. Man is a being who can be regarded as living dependent on time and looking at events only from the present moment. Yet the future is closed to him. He is not always able to see the long-term wisdom, beauty, and benefits in the events he encounters. Yet God, who created time, sees and knows the lives of all time-dependent beings from outside time. What we are now dealing with is the fact of fate. Fate means God knowing every single event in the past and future in a single moment. In other words, events the end results of which are unknown, are only actually unknown to us. God is fully aware of all the things we are not, together with their pasts and futures. For this reason, the beginning and end of the test people are subjected to in this world are already clear. The past, present, and future are all one in the sight of God. They are all over and done with. We, however, only learn of these events by experiencing them when the time comes. This knowledge of fate is truly great knowledge, and something of which those who deny God are unaware. It is knowledge by means of which Muslims display great patience in the face of difficulties and tests in this world. They live in the peace and security of knowing that everything that happens to them is destined. As is revealed in the Quran, no misfortune occurs except by God's permission. Whoever believes in God, he will guide his heart. God has knowledge of all things.
MashaAllah. So Allah created our infinite lives, inshallah, as an infinite part of a single moment, inshallah, and finished it. And Allah determined destiny in the best way. So we have to submit and surrender to Allah, inshallah.
Yes.
To our destinies. It is created by Allah, who has infinite wisdom, infinite mercy, infinite love, and inshallah, infinite power, mashallah.
Inshallah. Allah created man and jinn in order for us to be tested, and in order to abide Him. And inshallah, to devote our whole life, our life and death to Him, inshallah.
Inshallah.
For the sake of Allah's great pleasure and His face, inshallah, in the hereafter, inshallah.
MashaAllah. So if you don't have anything to add, we came to you.
To another end of our program, yes.
End of the program, inshallah. Inshallah, tomorrow we'll be together at the same time, 2:30 a.m., GMT plus 2. And with scientific application of Darwinism, science leading to faith, and faith-related topics, inshallah. Until then, selamun aleyküm, shalom, good day, and good night, everybody.
Selamun aleyküm.